Good morning and welcome to the 8th meeting in 2023 of the Economy and Fair Work Committee. Apologies have been received from Claire Baker, Maggie Chapman and Colin Smith. Now, our first item of business is the fourth evidence session of our inquiry into a just transition for the Grangemouth area. And today's session will focus on how innovation and just transition can be supported via partnership working across national bodies. I'd like to welcome Derek Shaw, Director of Innovation and Place Scottish Enterprise, Mark Munro, Interim Head of Investment Origination, and David Ritchie, Executive Director for Partnerships and Engagement, both from Scottish National Investment Bank. Now, as always, I ask members and witnesses to keep their questions and answers as concise as possible. Let me start with the first question, which is very straightforward. How do the Scottish National Investment Bank and Scottish Enterprise support the decarbonisation of industry in Scotland, particularly in Grangemouth? And what are the constraints and barriers that you face? And maybe I can ask Derek to start off on that.
Yeah, delighted to do so. Thanks very much, convener, for that question. So we support Grangemouth in a number of ways through our global account management service, where there's nine international and Indigenous companies that we support through investment, innovation and our international activities. We work with foreign direct investors who are looking at opportunities in Scotland to identify potential locations within the Grangemouth area and promote Grangemouth as a centre of excellence in terms of the existing industrial cluster that's there, as well as the emerging opportunities there are for net zero and decarbonisation. We work with the company base, as I mentioned, the nine companies there. We also invest into those companies where it's appropriate to do so. For example, we have invested into Celtic Renewables, quite substantial investment into that business over the number of years, which has allowed it to construct that new facility at Grangemouth, and we're starting to see the benefits of that. We have wider support to SMEs through the products and services that we provide, sustainability, innovation support, fair work, workplace development, as well as investment and internationalisation. Specifically on Grangemouth and decarbonisation, we're progressing work around the bioeconomy, and we're currently undertaking industry and supply chain research to identify and map future opportunities for low carbon at Grangemouth. We're developing a package of research to help identify new product opportunities and global best practice around industrial cluster development around decarbonisation. We're working with Falkirk Council and other partners on the growth deal, and we're looking at biotechnology and carbon dioxide utilisation and storage facility, as well as a zero emissions vehicle centre of excellence. We work with Forth Valley Council on skills, and we're working through our Scottish Development International arm to support inward investment into the sector.
You mentioned there about carbon capture, which is a hugely expensive and as yet slightly untried technology. What sort of investment are you putting into this?
Our investment is through our support, through our people, and working with partners, including INEOS at Grangemouth, who are part of the ACORN project that you'll be aware of, to support the development of the business case for the ACORN project, and promoting that as a centre of excellence within the UK. Where there's opportunities to financially invest, then we would do so. But to date, our resource and our input and investment has been people within Scottish Enterprise working with partners to develop that opportunity in partnership with INEOS.
Now, I also mentioned about constraints and barriers. Where do you perceive these?
So I think one of the major barriers, constraints, is the level of investment that will be needed. The challenge to decarbonise Grangemouth is significant, But the opportunities are massive, both for Grangemouth and for Scotland. But to meet those challenges and to capitalise on those opportunities will require significant levels of investment, multi-billion pounds of investment in infrastructure, in new technologies, in companies. So that is a challenge that we need to work collectively to overcome. The second one, as I would say, is around skills. So we've got a fantastic heritage in skills and experience at Grangemouth, which we need to capitalise on in terms of that just transition into to the new economy. But there is, as we know, a skills shortage within Scotland, within the UK. And therefore, when we're looking further afield, 5, 10, 15 years down the line, in terms of some of these new technologies that we're looking to capitalise on, like hydrogen and carbon capture, we'll need to ensure that we've got the right skills and we're developing those skills now.
David, would you like to comment on this?
Yeah, well, thank you very much for the invitation, convener, and I'm delighted to participate. For the bank, sorry, is my speaker on? For the bank, we try and look across the piece at the decarbonisation agenda. So we are looking at how the bank can support investments, which supports the decarbonisation of generation, electricity generation. We're also looking at how the bank can support decarbonisation across heat. We are very interested and very focused in thinking about how the bank's investments can support decarbonisation of transport. And we're also very keen to support the decarbonisation of industry. We recognise the significant economic value that Grangemouth brings to the Scottish economy, both in terms of GVA impact, but also in terms of employment. And we, as a bank, are actively trying to engage with companies in the Grangemouth area to find ways in which we can help them support pivots from their existing activity, which might be more higher energy intensive and oil and gas related, and help them pivot to more lower carbon sectors and industries. At the bank, we're looking at commercial opportunities, both in terms of projects and businesses that we can look to invest in. We work closely with our partners in Scottish Government and Scottish Enterprise to try and identify a pipeline of credible projects where the bank can offer its commercial support. And we're really keen to not only offer our commercial investment, but also our expertise and insight into how the economy can transition in a meaningful way. Up to this point, we have spoken to several businesses from the Grangemouth area, and those conversations are ongoing. As we go forward and develop our approach to investment and origination and really begin to focus our activity around how the bank can support the development of the hydrogen economy, for example, we see that as a fantastic opportunity for Grangemouth and something that the bank is very keen to help enable.
Now, you haven't mentioned about constraints and barriers that that would be affecting your ability to invest and engage there. Could you maybe elaborate a little bit on that?
Sure. As Derek has just said, I mean, I think one of the big challenges is the scale of investment that's required, but also trying to identify sustainable investment models and business models that can be invested into. So hydrogen at the moment is a fantastic opportunity. It has potential opportunity around heat, it has a potential opportunity around transport, but particularly within the context of Grangemouth, it is a fantastic opportunity as a potential feedstock for that area and the industries that are there, as well as an opportunity for export in due course as well. At the moment, there is not sort of identified sustainable business model in place that allows hydrogen, the hydrogen industry, to develop at scale. And one of the key things that we are keen to see and keen to support is the identification of projects which helps prove that business model. That's something that we are looking to agitate around and help create, but it's not there at the moment. I think another big challenge is skills. When we look at the skills that are required for the transition from high energy intensive stroke oil and gas type industries into lower carbon or renewables sectors, there is a process that's going to be have to be gone through in terms of retraining and reskilling. That is happening, but whether it's happening at the scale that's required at the moment, I'm not so sure. So I think that's a huge challenge.
Mark, do you have anything you would like to add?
Good morning, sorry, and thank you. Just to build on the points of David and Derek, and you asked about the bank's role, I think we're clear that we see it as providing transition capital in and around Grangemouth and in these other areas that David spoke of, those high-intensive energy sectors as well as the oil and gas areas. That's reflective of debt and equity capital being withdrawn from these sectors over the last few years. And we need these sectors to help us transition to the future, so that in the next 3, 4, 5 years, the bank's role will be to provide the bridge of capital to enable investment to move from these industries into the renewable industries of tomorrow.
The Scottish National Investment Bank has got three missions which guide investment decisions, and one of these is, very importantly, is about supporting a just transition to net zero. Can you maybe talk me through how your approach is to the allocation of resources and investment decisions on that? How do you scrutinise a project, and how do you satisfy yourself that it will support that just transition? And I suppose ask you, what's your understanding of just in a just transition? David, I'm going to come to you first on that. Or is it Mark that would be there?
Happy to. So which part would you like me to answer first, just on the...
Oh, just pick one.
I'll maybe start with how we're set up. Until maybe 6-9 months ago, the bank was set up based upon the mission, so the investment teams reflected the three missions that we had. But the reality is every member of the bank has a responsibility to deliver the three missions. We're also much clearer on the opportunities and the demand of the bank since we opened in November 2020. So the way we're structured now is around an active origination strategy. And what that involves is identifying the areas that the bank can create the greatest value and have the most impact upon. At a highest level, those are around sort of scalable technology, the built environment around decarbonising residential and commercial buildings in Scotland and industries, and then offshore wind and alternative energies. So we now have teams set up focused on these areas. In terms of the second part of your question, a just transition, my view is that we're seeking to ensure that no group or community are disadvantaged as Scotland and the world moves from being a fossil fuel powered economy to a renewable powered economy. And to the point I made earlier, I think the bank's role is to provide that transition capital so that we don't have businesses and projects that are needed for the future without access to capital, be it debt or equity. And if the bank can take the necessary catalyst positions, then we can crowd back in the capital that in the last few years has stood back from these important industries.
I think one of the discussions we've had around this table over a period has been the definition of a just transition. Your quotation is virtually the Scottish Government's interpretation of it, which is fine. But how do you as a bank actually define that and make it part of what you're doing? You know, just means different. Just transition means different things to different people, as we found. How do you weave it into your investment decision?
There's always two lenses to an opportunity that has been presented to the bank. It's in 2 years we've had 815 opportunities presented to us, and in that time we now have a portfolio of 24. One is the commercial opportunity, and just as importantly is the impact that can be created from our investment. We obviously go through quite an extensive due diligence process, and within that we use that time to convince ourselves that they are meaningful in what they're saying. So we always look for meaningful action. If we take a business that is perhaps being more fossil fueled aligned that would be in and around the Grangemouth area, what we'd like to see would be that they've potentially not invested lots of money, but they're very meaningful. So one, they've declared a strategy to support net zero and just transition. The second is they may have appointed an individual into that role. Now, they may have not had an opportunity to have any impact on that business, but it's meaningful. And that's to avoid those businesses that will come to us. Maybe have read the website and sort of regurgitate that back to us. So we need to see that meaningful action that's sort of occurred within those businesses and projects. And then is supported from the due diligence we undertake, which will range from technical to financial to management due diligence. So it's quite extensive and lots of options open to us.
Thank you. I'd like to turn to Graeme Simpson, followed by Gordon MacDonald.
Thanks very much, and good morning. I just want, could I start off with SNIB, if that's okay, David or Mark? Well, actually, David, because you said, correct me if I'm wrong, but I get the impression that you're not actually involved in any companies in the Grangemouth area at the moment, but you would like to be. And you said you're speaking to a number of businesses. What sort of businesses are you speaking to in the Grangemouth area?
Sure, yes. Yeah. So we haven't invested in any company in Grangemouth at the moment, but we are having discussions with businesses who you could classify as traditionally in the sort of oil and gas sector, who are thinking about transitioning and they're already on the path to transition. Those conversations are at various stages of advancement. What we have said to those businesses is that we are keen to support them transition, but also helping them understand what the bank has been set up to deliver, particularly around the commercial component of it, as well as the sort of mission impact component of it.
So are there restrictions on, you know, what you could invest, you know, what you would get back?
So for every investment that we look to deliver, we always look to get a commercial return. So in terms of when the bank was established by the Scottish Government, utilising public capital in a commercial way was central to what we were doing. We also have at the heart of all of our activity mission impact considerations. So when we speak to any business, we look at the business through both of those lenses. So if it's not delivering a commercial return or we don't feel that the business model is sustainable, that would have implications for how we would then advance that project. That wouldn't to say that we wouldn't do it, but we would pause and seek other reassurance that they were going to move the business into a more commercial space and have a sustainable business model. And then in terms of the impact, if the business wasn't demonstrating that it was able to deliver the impacts that we would want to see as a bank, whether that's through our net zero mission or the impacts we would want to see from a place perspective or social perspective, then that would be a consideration that we would have to take.
Okay. Can I turn to you, Derek, because you did list a number of projects that you're involved with. I just wonder if you could tell us a little bit more. I was quite interested in this zero emissions vehicle centre of excellence. Was that the right phrase?
Yes, it is indeed, and that's one of the projects that's been developed and hopefully delivered through the Falkirk Growth Deal, which has been led by Falkirk Council. So we are, and that's part of their innovative industries theme. And we are heavily involved in working with Falkirk Council and partners around that project in particular, but also the carbon capture utilisation project as well, as well as some others. So that's part of the overall activity that we are progressing as part of the growth deal and part of the work that we're doing with Grangemouth, in addition to the companies that are already located there and supporting them on an individual basis, as well as working through our SDI division to target inward investors that potentially could look to locate at Grangemouth.
Okay. So is just to explain that a bit further, is that project about developing new technologies to allow vehicles to, you know, be zero emission?
It's about electrification of vehicles and the testing of new technology that ultimately could then be scaled up if that technology is viable, scaled up and manufactured in Scotland. And I think that's the key focus for ourselves in terms of working with especially new early stage businesses that are at the cutting edge of technology, is to support them with that technology development, but also looking at the end prize in terms of the manufacturing potential in Scotland, because what we want to ensure is that the economic impact from those technologies are maximised for Scotland, and in a lot of cases that is ensuring that the end result in terms of manufacturing, which could be years down the line, lands in Scotland and particularly Grangemouth.
Okay. You mentioned a particular company, Celtic Renewables.
Yeah.
Who I think make biofuels.
Yeah.
I think I'm right in saying. So what's your involvement there? Are you trying to, obviously they make biofuels, but are you trying to link them up with people who might use the biofuels? What's your actual involvement there?
So we've been involved with Celtic Renewables pretty much since the company was formed. So we provided commercial investment through our growth investment arm alongside private sector investors, which initially allowed the initial technology to be tested and developed at a very small scale. We provided support through innovation and account management. Recent investments over recent years has been to construct a facility at Grangemouth to scale up their technology, and that's currently where the company is at. Where we are just now is supporting them on that technology development roadmap, ensuring that the technology works, and then it can then lead to kind of commercial success and linking them with partners, with customers, for the kind of future expansion of that business. That's one example. As I said, there's other companies, Petronas, Pidemal, Fujifilms, Versalis, and Syngenta, and Suez are other companies that we work with.
Okay. I'll ask you, it might be a tricky question. I'm not trying to catch you out, but the government's going to produce a just transition plan for Grangemouth. Can you think of anything that you would like to be in that plan?
So I think,
Snib, you'll get this one as well.
So I think that the key is ensuring that we're maximising on the opportunity. So it goes back to the question around what is a just transition. So for me, and I don't know whether this is the correct definition or not, but it's kind of two parts. So it's ensuring that the process of transition and the organisations, the people, the communities that are impacted on that transition are part of the process and feel part of the engagement around that transition, so that the impacts, and they could be negative impacts, are mitigated. But then secondly, it's looking about the opportunities, and there are significant opportunities in Grangemouth and across Scotland for our transition to net zero. How do we maximise those opportunities for all? So for individuals located at Grangemouth, for companies that are located at Grangemouth and across Scotland, and using Grangemouth essentially in the centre of excellence that we've currently got is a test bed for developing our technologies across the piece. So for me, in terms of what would be in that plan, is ensuring that people, communities that are impacted by the just transition benefit from that transition to a newer, greener economy.
And SNP.
So, I mean, I think from a business perspective, I think the plan has to have a focus on the existing businesses which are looking to transition, whether that's them transitioning by becoming more energy efficient industries themselves, or by transitioning into more lower carbon sectors, you know, so transition away from oil and gas to renewables. I think that has to be a central component of it. But I think there has to be something in there about not just the existing business base, but how you can create opportunities for new businesses to emerge and to scale and grow. And those businesses might be spinning out of existing oil and gas businesses or petrochemical businesses, but at the same time, those businesses could spin out of our university sector and be located in Grangemouth, where you could potentially create a real hub of expertise. So I think that would be two key components of it. I think that the point around having the community at the heart of this and social impact at the heart of this is also important. So, you know, with a lot of our investments or all of our investments, we look to try and build in not just the commercial consideration, but also the social impact. So trying to ensure that local communities benefit from an investment, whether that's through apprenticeship opportunities or whether that's through skills or just more general job opportunities in the investment. And I think that needs to be a key consideration of any plan that's put forward.
Yeah, that's actually come out in a lot of the evidence we've had already.
Okay.
That, you know, there needs to be a local benefit. So you've both made that point. Convener, that's my questions.
Okay, thank you. Gordon MacDonald, followed by Michelle Thompson.
Thanks very much, Convener. We've started to touch on the area that I wanted to look at. When Derek, earlier on you said that Scottish Enterprise are carrying out research to identify investment opportunities in the Grangemouth area. And I was wanting to ask you about jobs. Last week, GMB Scotland noted that hydrogen and carbon capture both offer the potential for jobs growth, but this does not guarantee retention of current levels of skilled jobs. So given that Scottish Enterprise has this role to create jobs but also safeguard jobs, when you're making investment decisions, how do you strike that balance between safeguarding existing skilled jobs and creating new job opportunities?
Thanks very much for that question. So when we undertake an appraisal of all investments that we make, jobs are at the forefront of that. What economic impact is going to be delivered as a consequence of the investment that we make? The creation of new jobs, high-value jobs, greener jobs is a key component of that, as is the ability to safeguard existing jobs. Now, I guess ultimately as we look at kind of just transition, how we then support the business base that are looking at new opportunities and transferring their business models, their opportunities, their markets into new opportunities that require new skills. How do we support that? So I think overall, I think last year, 2021, we safeguarded or created and safeguarded over 13,000 jobs with the activity that we undertook. So safeguarding is a key component of what we look at, but so is the creation of new jobs and particularly green jobs.
And similar to SNB, I mean, how do you guys look at, you know, we're in a period of time where there is this transition going on. When you're making investment decisions, how do you safeguard existing jobs and you're not undermining skills that are currently required in the economy?
When we undertake the investments and through the impact covenants that we would set, we do seek to ensure that those businesses are providing opportunities for those in those roles to actually move across. So it's either providing the necessary training that's required so they can maintain their existing skills and learn learn new skills, and that's something that's really coming through in a lot of the sort of transition capital finance that we're being asked for in the last 12 months, because going back to what I said earlier, there has been a flight of capital, both debt and equity, from fossil fuel-based revenue companies. So we do ask them to provide that opportunity to move across without forgetting the skill sets that are important today.
And David, you spoke about the importance of local communities, and you mentioned apprentices, skills and jobs. Grangemouth Community Council suggested, when they were given evidence last week, that there should be a percentage of jobs kept for local people. I mean, is that something that you guys consider when you're doing investments?
We definitely consider the local impact on the community. We haven't built in any specific quotas into any sort of covenants or any impacts that we would want to see. But for every investment that we do, we speak to the investee company about engaging with the local community. We speak to them about engaging with local providers from an apprenticeship perspective and colleges perspective. And we speak in quite a lot of depth about skills and training opportunities. We actively encourage all of the investee companies to engage on those issues. And we actively encourage them to engage more generally with the community to help them understand what the business is trying to deliver and how that can be beneficial to the community from a wider economic perspective, but also from an employment perspective. But on the specific point of quotas and percentages, that's not something that we compel businesses to do.
Okay. And Derek, you know, same question to you about local jobs for local people. But in addition to that, what do you do about considering growing local supply chains when you're looking at investing in the Grangemouth area?
Thanks very much. So in terms of local people, again, that is a consideration that we take into account. We don't take it to the extent that we specify within our investment conditions when we're providing support that jobs have got to be created within the locality. We would certainly encourage through our account management service management teams to do that. I think there's a wider point actually that I was just reflecting on that conversation in terms of the job opportunities, whether it's retention or creation of new jobs, the wider opportunities in terms of the sectors and the new technologies. As we discussed, it's massive, and the challenges are massive, but the opportunity is great. And we need to ensure within Scotland that Team Scotland, the public sector agencies, are working collaboratively and coordinated. And then we're working together with the private sector. So being joined up with the likes of Skills Development Scotland, Transport Scotland, the bank, and other agencies, so that when we're looking at a proposition, and a significant proposition, we're bringing those collective skills and experience around the table, and particularly around jobs and skills, ensuring that SDS is around the table. In terms of your second question around supply chain, absolutely, that is a key consideration for us, and increasingly so, particularly following COVID, and the need to bring back supply chains within Scotland and domestically. So when we are looking at supporting companies, whether that's investment or just wider support, it's worth encouraging management teams, companies to think about actually where they're sourcing their product from, can they source it in Scotland, and making connections between companies that we have relationships with, really to get the biggest bang for the investment that we're making. So it's not just about that company and the jobs that they're creating, important though it is, but what's the wider supply chain benefits that could be achieved from that investment overall.
Okay, thanks very much.
Thank you. Michelle Thompson, followed by Fiona Hislop.
Good morning. We've touched on some of my themes a wee bit earlier in terms of the role and involvement of the local community. We had some quite compelling evidence last week from the Grangemouth and Skinflats Community Council that kind of depicted that they feel as though they bear the weight of providing all this GDP to the Scottish economy, but they don't get the benefits. So, Derek, I think you said earlier that obviously, and you've referenced Celtic Renewables and so on, you're already investing in local companies. But in terms of your impact assessment vis-a-vis the benefits to the local community, can you talk me through the process you use? In other words, what did you specifically do to ensure that impact, the benefit was felt within the community? And I totally appreciate you've got a wider perspective as well.
Thank you for that question. I guess it goes through the support that we provide at account management service. So working with those businesses in the locations that they're in, so not just necessarily Grangemouth, but looking at where businesses are located, where the skills are needed for that particular business, and encouraging those companies to source those skills in their local area. As I mentioned there, we don't take that to the extent that it's a condition of our support, that ultimately they've got to secure jobs or recruit people in the local area. But we're certainly focused on working with companies to encourage that. Another thing that I would say is we work at both a regional and a local level. So through we've got 7 regions within the Scottish Enterprise area. So we're working with partners and stakeholders through regional economic partnerships. And then again, that's focusing not particular region and the strengths and the opportunities within that. And then we're also involved at kind of local level through community planning partnerships, bringing in again community individuals and the issues and the challenges and the opportunities at a local level, and how potentially Scottish Enterprise can support those opportunities.
And I think you must have guessed what my next question was going to be, because you alluded to it in terms of conditionality. Because, I'm paraphrasing, but I think the sense from the community was that a lot of the activity that was going on was well-intentioned to include the community and have like this kind of community focus at its heart, but it lacked substance. So I suppose my question to you is, what would be the circumstances where you think, well, it'd be a good idea to put some conditionality around the funds that you provide? What would that look like? Where would you see that working to really try and make sure they're at the heart of what you're doing?
So maybe start by the conditionality that we put on companies just now. So we were an early adopter of Fair Work First, so requiring businesses that are receiving our support to commit to Fair Work principles, including paying the living wage, but implementing the Fair Scotland duty, which asks listed public authorities, including Scottish Enterprise, to do more to tackle inequalities caused by socio-economic disadvantage. So when we're looking at those principles and those policies, that then embeds a degree of conditionality around the projects and the activity that we are supporting. And that's part of our wider equality impact assessment, where we're checking that the policies, the projects that we're supporting, how is that impacting on particular groups, so that we're ensuring that there's equality overall of the provision of funding and this wider support in terms of our people. There could be more that we could be doing, I think that's something that I will take back within Scottish Enterprise and have discussions about what additional conditionality potentially would be appropriate to implement.
Yeah, and I absolutely understand about the principles of fair work, and I think that would be very helpful, because you'll be at the coalface in terms, because obviously you're monitoring the existing investments. What are your suggestions for how that those principles can be deepened to really put the community at the heart? And I suppose then turning to SNIB, obviously, as you've explained earlier, you've not made any investments, but how would you go about in terms of your kind of impact assessment to ensure that the community is at the heart? And to what extent is there a conflict when obviously you're skating across the top looking at return on investment and your debt equity ratios and so on? But I'd be interested, I appreciate it's in principle given what you said earlier, but
I'll maybe just go first. Good business involves a local community, you know, so it's the returns will come with maintaining that social license. So it's not that it it needs to achieve that particular level. I'll let David elaborate, but all of what we do is around maintaining that social licence with the opportunities and the businesses that we've invested within. And to that end, the examples would be seeking to maximise the local supply chain in around the area so that the benefits are available, but also touching on what we spoke about just previously, the training and apprenticeship opportunities for local people as well.
You got anything to add to?
Sure. So when we first start engaging with a business, we encourage them to be speaking to the local community, not just through the sort of statutory requirements that a business has to undertake, but just being more proactive in helping the local community understand what the business is trying to deliver. We haven't done any investments in Grangemouth, as I mentioned at the outset, but maybe try to put some life to this in terms of some of the other investments that we've done. So when we did the Highland Coast Hotels investment, which was an investment in a series of hotels to improve the infrastructure in the North Coast 500 route, we actively worked with that company to not only get them to engage with the community, but also to work with the University of Highlands and Islands to help develop the skills that would be required for that sector, so that those in the local community could be skilled and then take advantage of the job opportunities that would emerge in due course. That's something that we do regularly when it comes to apprenticeships as well with other businesses. Another area as well where we've worked quite extensively on was when we did the M Squared investment, which was a technology investment in the sort of Glasgow area. We worked with that business to encourage them to undertake initiatives that promotes female participation in STEM subjects, which was underrepresented from a female participation perspective. So we actively speak to the company, identify areas where we feel that they can make a meaningful impact, and encourage them to have that dialogue with the community and local community.
And can I assume you then assess outcome as compared to initial?
Okay. Yes, and I think we're about to publish our impact report in April this year, which will be give a comprehensive insight into how the bank is measuring impact, and creates a very good baseline for us to track progress against. We've only been operational for 2 years, and as Mark mentioned in his earlier comments, we only made 24 investments. So trying to identify short-term impact does have its challenges, but we feel that by correcting the right data in the right areas, that gives us an excellent baseline to then track progress against over time, and for us to be assessed ourselves, to assess ourselves against, but also for Parliament to hold us to account on these areas too.
And perhaps more for Derek, just finishing off this bit, could you see the benefit of building in sort of community benefit requirement mechanisms to kind of square off the circle, if you like, in some of these investments?
I think in terms of the companies that we're working with and how they are supporting local communities, local business through supply chains. So that is definitely a consideration when we're working with businesses around the locality in which they're located, maximising the opportunities at a local level, both in terms of skills, but in terms of supply chain.
Okay. Slightly different question before I finish up. I think, am I correct, you're involved in the Grangemouth Future Industry Board or on that. Tell me a bit more about your involvement and also what's your understanding of its governance model?
Yeah, so alongside Scottish Government, I'm the co-chair of the Grangemouth Future Industry Board. So it's now in its third year of operation. I think in submission to the committee, we had mentioned that it's went through three phases. So the first phase was pretty much its inception in terms of getting GFIB up and running, putting the governance structure in place, getting partners involved in that. And the key purpose of GFIB, as you're aware, is to ensure that there's collaboration, visibility, coordination across the public sector. So there's a number of public sector organisations, the Council, SEPA, Skills Development Scotland, Scottish Government, amongst others, that are partners in GFIB. The second phase was then actually taking the governance structure forward in terms of development and delivery. So we established five work streams, key work streams, each led by a partner within GFIB, and really developing out those work streams. So for Scottish Enterprise, we lead on project development and strategic investment. And we have, and as part of that second phase, started to build a pipeline of activity around that. And then now we're in the third phase, which is engaging with industry and Scottish Government leading on the development of a just transition plan for Grangemouth. And part of that just transition plan, first phase will be looking at baselining, so looking at the companies that are already there, the number of jobs that are there, the emissions within the industrial sector, the opportunities that can be taken forward in terms of that transition, and engaging with industry, with local community groups around the vision for Grangemouth and that just transition going forward. I would say that, as I've kind of mentioned, all of us that are involved in GFIB in terms of the partners and engage with industry day in, day out in various different forms. And I think the key for me now in the third year is ensuring that public sector and private sector and the industry that are there, potentially the industry that could be located there, are working jointly on the challenges and the significant opportunities in a coordinated fashion. Mm-hmm. As I said, we're doing that individually, but now there's an opportunity to frame that as a kind of collective.
And you've given me a lot of helpful information about what you're doing in your various phases, but I must admit I'm not any clearer about understanding the governance model and specifically who's ultimately accountable for the output of the GFIB.
So ultimately it's ministers
on the GFIB itself, surely there's an accountable, how's that structured from a governance point of view?
So there's co-chair with Scottish Enterprise and Scottish Government with the partners represented. On an annual basis, we agree priorities for the year ahead. Ministers sign off those priorities, the ministers are updated on a regular basis in terms of progress against that plan. Just now, I believe Scottish Government and I think maybe Andy Hogg, who's the fellow co-chair, is maybe coming to the committee in April. Officials are updating ministers about the future direction now.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Fiona Hislop, followed by Jamie Halker-Johnson.
Thank you and good morning and thank you for joining us. Can I just maybe follow up a wee bit on the Grangemouth Future Industry Board? Is that the body that's going to be producing the Just Transition Plan or the majority of content of it for Grangemouth?
Yeah, so the Scottish Government are going to lead on the development of that plan, but with significant input from GFIB. But in isolation, it won't be just GFIB in itself. There will be industry involved and the community as well. So that's the next stage in that process in terms of the vision is collectively coming together. So GFIB partners, industry and local community groups to input into what the vision is for a just transition for Grangemouth.
And what we've heard to date is we heard specifically last week, it's not just the future industries that have an interest in a just transition from Grangemouth. Yeah. It's actually the rest of the business sector in Grangemouth as well. So where do they get a voice if they're not on the Future Industry Board?
So the intention is that we will develop a kind of workshop approach to develop the vision for the Just Transition Plan for Grangemouth and industry and the existing companies that are there will be part and a central part of that process, so that we're coming together collectively, the public and the private sector, to discuss what the challenges, what the opportunities are, and ultimately what we believe the vision to be for that just transition at Grangemouth. So they will, industry and the companies that are already there will be a central component of that process.
Okay, well, that's maybe something we'll explore separately about how the rest of business within Grangemouth can be part of this. There are obviously a lot of overlapping policy initiatives affecting the Grangemouth area and the transition. We've got the Falkirk Growth Deal, we've got the Fourth Green Port, we've got the UK government's levelling up in investments, and obviously, as we've just heard, the upcoming Just Transition Plan. So how does Scottish Enterprise specifically engage with all these different policies, initiatives to steer what you can add value to?
Thanks for that question. So there is a lot of policy in place. I think Scottish Enterprise is clear in our focus, which is to support companies to innovate, to scale and to transform the economy. But ultimately, we do that in the context of existing government policy. And for Scottish Enterprise in particular, it's the National Strategy for Economic Transformation. And then there's obviously other policies and energy policies, hydrogen, that come underneath that. What I would say is a couple of points. First is that we've got very good relationships with government colleagues from a policy perspective. So we help government in terms of our knowledge and experience, the views that from our customer base and particularly business in terms of shaping policy. Now, ultimately, it's for government to develop policy, but we have good relationships, as I said, that allow us to input into that process. And then importantly for Scottish Enterprise, it's around delivery. So looking at the existing policies that are already in place and how Scottish Enterprise can have a role in delivering against those ambitions. And it may well be that there's some activity within some policies that is not for Scottish Enterprise, and that's absolutely fine. So we need to be clear what our role is in terms of delivery against government's ambitions. And kind of going back to the point that I made earlier, it's absolutely key for us and for other organisations that we're working collectively as a kind of Team Scotland on delivery of policy and our own objectives, and we're not working in isolation. And I think we've seen that increasingly over the last couple of years in particular, where we're having a much more joined up approach with other agencies to look at it collectively and holistically and how we can support government. And as I said, that may mean that in some occasions it's for other partner organisations to take the lead and for Scottish Enterprise to support. In other occasions it may be for the SE to support and others to lead and others to support.
And referring to all those different policy initiatives, if I can refer to the Scottish National Investment Bank now, which or any of them are you directly involved in, or are you just monitoring that to look for opportunities?
So we're not directly involved in the shaping of those policies. We have interaction with government as we would expect, given that they're our sole shareholder. The main sort of strategy and policy that guides us is the missions that ministers have set us. You know, so the net zero transition, and they're long term missions. So net zero transition takes out to 2045, and we are focused on that. We've had engagement with government around the development of the national economic strategy, and we feel that that's entirely consistent with the missions that have been set for us. And we have regular interaction when there is significant strategies being developed, like the energy strategy at the moment and the innovation strategy at the moment, so we feed into that. But we're guided by the missions that have been set for us and how those fit into the sort of macroeconomic strategy for Scotland, which is around the economic transformation.
And what's very striking is Grangemouth would actually fit all your missions, the three missions. Very, you know, the play space, the innovation, and also the carbon reduction net zero. Yeah. And being ambitious about what could happen, the opportunity for the people and the community of Grangemouth to benefit from hydrogen heating or transport, etc., is really, really quite striking. Is that something that you're actively involved in looking at, and would that be an ideal fit? I'm not saying you have to commit your money, resources or decision making just now, but does that look as if it could be a potential fit for National Investment Bank where there isn't other investments to come, or even an opportunity for you to crowd in the private investments that would be interested in what would be very innovative work in this area?
Absolutely. I mean, I think it's almost like right in the sweet spot for us, you know. So there's a transition component from existing businesses who are looking to pivot. But as I mentioned in some of my earlier comments, when we were talking about what should be included in the sort of Grangemouth plan, I think it's absolutely critical that there's a space in that for new and emerging businesses. And I think that fits very neatly with what we are trying to deliver through our innovation and innovation mission. And in response to Michelle Thompson's question earlier on, we are really thoughtful around the local impact of our investments, and really keen to see that local supply chains are used, there's local employment opportunities, there's opportunities to link with local colleges or universities in order to improve skills. And when we look at the scale of the challenge around Grangemouth and the opportunity around Grangemouth, I think it speaks to all of the missions of the bank. And when we engage with businesses and projects, it's through that lens.
Sorry, Mark.
Yeah, just add to that. And when we say new businesses, we're actually meaning existing businesses as well. It's more that they'll have new products or service lines that will then be sort of suitable for what that next phase looks like. So it doesn't just mean a business that's on paper today. It can be the existing businesses in the community, in the local area, that can be part of that as well. And we would support that.
And I think that's critical, because place-based also means what the existing businesses. It's not all about new businesses. So.
And innovative. You know, they might want to change the way they do something, or evolve one of the products or say, or the service. And again, the bank has a role in supporting that. So when we say new businesses, it's more those new products and services that are needed for the future.
And that helps us, because we, you know, part of what we want to do is see what we think should be in the Just Transition plan for Grangemouth. Mm-hmm. And it's not always going to be about new businesses. And that's why I'm going to come back to Derek, if that's okay. Can I just apologise? It was my phone that went off. I was trying to Google to see if Celtic Renewables were a Scottish company or an Irish company. So that was my fault for making the interruption. Can you maybe tell me if...
Scottish company.
Yeah, okay. And in terms of the Scottish Enterprises now focus on hydrogen, it's very welcome. I'm very pleased to see that. To what extent are you focusing on trying to help existing businesses in supply chain potential for what could happen in hydrogen? Or to what extent, as we know historically, Scottish Enterprise and SDI have had a kind of focus, understandably, because of the innovation and the investments that can come from inward investment. So is that rebalancing so you can help smaller companies, maybe existing companies, pivot into potential supply chain development?
Yeah, it's absolutely both. Excuse me. So it's working with existing companies that are looking at new opportunities, and that might be new opportunities in the low carbon space. It might be opportunities around productivity, around innovation, better ways of doing things, more efficient ways of process innovation, product innovation, leading to greater levels of productivity. It's supporting existing companies looking at new market opportunities and pivot into new market opportunities where it's right for that business. And we've got lots of examples, particularly during COVID, actually, where we supported companies with new opportunities and pivoting with their business models. So absolutely a combination of working with existing businesses, also promoting those new opportunities as we see them, and the supply chain is absolutely key to that. And one of the kind of greater focuses that we're placing now is the green energy supply chain or the low carbon supply chain. So looking at electrification of vehicles, decarbonisation of heat, hydrogen, offshore wind, how does that all come together and what does the supply chain for that look like, particularly around high value manufacturing, and how can we support existing companies, small, medium and large, to capitalise on those opportunities, as well as working with inward investors that are looking to invest into Scotland, sometimes for the first time, or maybe they're already located here and looking for the expansion plan. So it's a combination of both.
And moving on to carbon capture, utilisation and storage and the potential there, we are hoping to maybe get an announcement from the budget, who knows, but there are concerns, and the other committee I sit on, the Net Zero Committee, produced a report, you know, expressing cross-party concerns about Acorn being on a reserve list, and quite clearly that project going ahead in Grangemouth will unlock so much in this area. So what is the specific role of Scottish Enterprise currently, but also if we can get that movement and that investment for Acorn to go ahead, what would your role be in that?
So currently it's working with partners as part of the Acorn project, and INEOS is part of that, to support those partners in terms of building the best possible business case for capturing that opportunity at Grangemouth. I do believe that the kind of phase two is imminent in terms of the UK government announcement on that, so we might hear on that shortly. So just now it's about supporting those partners in terms of how we can build the best business case possible. If we are successful in securing that, it's then looking at what support Scottish Enterprise could provide along with other partners to really capitalise on that amazing opportunity. And it goes back to that point around the supply chain, looking at the assets that are already there in Grangemouth and how that connects in with other regions within Scotland, so that it's not only Grangemouth that's ultimately benefiting from that opportunity, but the wider economy across Scotland and other parts of the region, including the North East as well.
And I can maybe ask the Scottish National Investment Bank, you know, have you got an interest in the Acorn project? Where would you see your positioning? Or is that something actually between the private investment from INEOS and others and Scottish Enterprise, you may not need to be in that space?
Well, we have engaged with partners of Acorn. And in short, I would say that the bank's role, if it's necessary, will provide capital to deliver the project once that model is clear for the partners.
Okay. And in terms, therefore, of the impact of this, can you perhaps share with us your understanding of the scale of the impact of the Acorn project once approved? And we're very hopeful it's delayed, but would be very welcome if it is announced. The impact not just for Grangemouth, for the rest of Scotland, and does that put Grangemouth in the kind of pilot position for that massive movement into that space, and particularly for hydrogen production as well?
Yeah, I don't have the details in terms of job numbers that could potentially lead to, but I mean, clearly it would be a massive coup for Grangemouth, a massive coup for Scotland, having that opportunity at Grangemouth. Strategically as well, I think it then positions Grangemouth really well in terms of that wider piece around just transition. So carbon capture, utilisation and storage, then looking at the opportunities around hydrogen, again working with INEOS and its investment, declared investment for that, a blue hydrogen implant. So you can see parts of the jigsaw really then firming up in terms of the significant opportunities, future opportunities coming board. But at this stage, I've not currently got the kind of information at hand, but I can certainly share that after the committee if that would be helpful.
Yes, convener, I think that would be very welcome. And then just finally, maybe to ask the Scottish National Investment Bank, clearly you've got your missions, you've got a responsibility to all of Scotland. We know that Grangemouth is particularly important strategically, currently and in the future. So how do you balance up that spread of investment so that you're serving all of Scotland, but being strategic as to where your investment is? How does that, who does that? How do you do that? And how do you do it in balance with Scottish Enterprise and other agencies?
The first lens that we apply is the mission lenses.
Yeah.
when we see an opportunity. And we do monitor our portfolio across those missions and across the spread of it across Scotland. So as it stands today, we've of the £380 million, we've invested £193 million across 13 projects in net zero, and that is across Scotland. We've invested £111 million across 7 projects within the Places mission, and we've invested £74 million within innovation across 10 projects. Again, that is across Scotland. I think every region of Scotland's received investment from those that £380 million. We also monitor our portfolio monthly as to what the portfolio would look like if we were to execute on the pipeline. At this moment in time, there is 56 live opportunities with an ask of £750 million of the bank. And we're cognizant of how that would then shape the portfolio so that we don't end up underserving one mission or one particular area of Scotland as well.
And just finally, if that's okay, Commissioner, for the bank, therefore, you know, your patient capital approach lends itself to technologies which aren't there yet, but we know will be needed at some point in the future. So do you think, particularly for the carbon capture, utilisation, storage, and also on hydrogen, and also for existing companies within the Grange Mouth area that could, as you suggested previously, you know, provide new products and services, is that potential, you know, that provides potential to meet all your different missions in terms of your investment?
It's a mission hat-trick, which we all look for across the three.
So is mission hat-trick, is that an official Scottish National Investment
Bank term? It's a strap line, perhaps. Okay. But sorry, in all seriousness, absolutely.
Yeah.
It would come across all of our missions.
David?
Yeah, can I just make a quick point? So I agree with everything that Mark has said. And we do look at projects on an individual basis, and we look at the merits of that project, but we also think about the big strategic opportunities for Scotland, you know, and ScotWind is a good example of that. So we're not looking at an individual project, we're looking at the opportunity that ScotWind might bring and thinking about what role the bank can play in that. The same could be said for Grangemouth. You know, Grangemouth delivers significant economic value to Scotland, high-value jobs, lots of expertise, lots of knowledge, lots of technology that can be applicable to the transition. And the bank sees itself as playing an important role in that. What's critical for us, though, is to try and engage with those businesses and identify how the bank's capital can support them either transition or scale or grow, and identifying what those business models are is pretty important to us.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Camille.
Thank you. I'll bring in Jamie Hawker-Johnson, followed by Graeme Simpson.
Thanks very much, Convener. Good morning to the panel. Sorry, I can't be there in person to speak to you. It's been very interesting. I was just looking to direct my questions to the Scottish National Investment Bank, and I'll maybe leave it to Mark and David to decide who's best to answer these. It was really on the hydrogen side. We've heard a lot about it during this inquiry, but also previously in evidence that we've taken in other areas. And I'd just be very keen to learn of where you feel the where you feel that sector will play its role. There seems to be, I wouldn't want to say a lack of clarity, but a lack of understanding perhaps on what it physically means, where hydrogen will, which sectors it will play a role, how it will be delivered, how it will be constructed. I was just wondering if you could tell me kind of how SNIB see that and how you might be supporting the infrastructure side of hydrogen.
Sure. Thank you for the question. So hydrogen has a key role in decarbonising the economy, and it is a significant economic opportunity. I think it'd be fair to say that we're not convinced that it will be for heating within residential houses. There may be areas on the islands that are more closed loop, or some areas of Scotland that are not on the what would be the current sort of gas network, nor for personal transport. But that doesn't mean it's not for transport more broadly. HGVs, public transport, it would be applicable. David touched upon it. There's a huge opportunity around Scotland and the supply chain, given hydrogen will be a key sort of byproduct of it. The question, if I'm being very honest with you, we're still answering ourselves, and I think can be part of the plan that's being put together is just Scotland can provide the supply of hydrogen. We've got the skill sets and, say, the opportunity I've just spoken of. Where we need more clarity is around where the demand is for the hydrogen and how we'll then get that hydrogen to where it's needed. There is some more work needed around that, in my view.
That's very helpful, Mark, and thank you for that. Honesty is very welcome. So, and I think that's what we're getting, or certainly I'm kind of getting from some of the discussions, that the concept, the idea is fantastic, providing and using kind of some of the power that we generate to create hydrogen, et cetera, looking forward. But the actual practical use in a lot of cases, maybe that vision isn't there. Where you talk about demand and identifying where the demand will be. Where is that work? Are you able to say where that work is happening? You say it needs to happen. Do you know where it's happening? Or is it something that perhaps you're waiting to see and then obviously able to kind of step in if there's opportunity to support?
We are working at bodies like the Net Zero Technology Centre. I've got they've done a lot of work in this area and have a views to where they're appropriate. I mean, the creation of things like ammonia is where the demand actually is, but it's then applying it from beyond that and dare I say it, the commercial business model that then supports the supply that we can create. But as I say, one example would be, and we work with them, would be the Net Zero Technology Centre. There's some universities in Scotland who are looking into this area as well. And again, we've had a couple of conversations on that.
Can I?
Okay, thank you.
Could I make a... Mr. Halko. Another area that's emerged recently that we are quite keen to understand ourselves in a bit more detail is hydrogen as a potential... substitute for gas-fired power stations. Obviously, methane is what is predominantly used in a power station at the moment, but there's emissions that are associated with that, greenhouse gas emissions that are associated with that, which presents challenges if you're looking to have a sort of zero carbon generation mix. But I think most people recognise that there's still a requirement for some form of base loads to complement your renewable generation. And there's been some recent thinking and discussion about hydrogen potentially being a source, a feedstock source for those power stations. It's not something that we've got into sufficient depth on yet, but it is an area that we are keen to look at, which could then potentially complement hydrogen's use, not just for as a feedstock for existing industrial capacity and the potential export that might bring as well, but also for domestic use from an electricity generation perspective too.
Thanks for that, David. Is that something that obviously work is happening on at the moment in terms of developing those kind of that idea?
Yeah, some of the early thinking of it has emerged from the Committee on Climate Change, who have released a recent report which discusses hydrogen as a potential source for electricity generation and helping to manage the base loads. That's what we're keen to get into in a bit more depth on. We're speaking to the Committee of Climate Change on that, and we want to crystallise our own views on that.
That's very helpful. I know this isn't going to be particularly related to this inquiry, but I just did also want to ask. We've obviously got Scottish Enterprise in today, but how are you engaged with Highlands and Islands Enterprise, my local enterprise board for the Highlands, obviously. How do you kind of engage with them on projects? Are there specific areas that you're looking at?
Yeah. Sorry, was that directed at you or me, Derek?
I'm not sure.
that was to you, David. Sorry.
That's to me. Yeah, sure. Yeah, very good engagement with Highlands and Islands Enterprise. We speak to them on a frequent basis to talk about projects that they're invested in or businesses that they are supporting who might be moving into the sort of scale that the National Investment Bank could then take over. That's related to a few projects, Orbex being one more recently that you might be familiar with. But we also done an investment into Highland Coast Hotels, where we spoke a lot to Highlands and Islands Enterprise about, and we have frequent interaction on and discussion about their pipeline and our pipeline and how we can work in partnership and collaborate.
That's very helpful. I mean, in previous inquiries, we've thought sometimes about the kind of move from smaller businesses out of, you know, Business Gateway into Highlands Islands Enterprise not always being so good. So that's encouraging to hear that's happening. That's all from me. Thank you very much indeed for your information there. Thanks, Convener.
Graham Simpson, can I bring you in now?
Yeah, thanks a lot. I just want to ask again about the Grangemouth Future Industry Board and its membership. Because just looking on the Scottish Government website and looking at the members, it seems to be all public sector. If that's wrong, this is to you, Derek, because you're on it. Is there any private sector membership?
No, not currently. The objective behind the establishment of the Grangemouth Future Industry Board was to ensure that there was a coordinated approach across the public sector. What we were finding in advance of GFIB being set up was that our respective organisations were having numerous conversations with different partners, different stakeholders, having the same conversations but not being joined up. So to ensure that we weren't kind of siloed, Scottish Government had established GFIB as an opportunity to bring that public sector partners together. I think the next stage of GFIB is how then we ensure that we're joined up with industry kind of going forward in the business space that's at Grangemouth.
But surely, I mean, the private sector are key to delivering a just transition in the Grangemouth area and indeed across Scotland. Surely if you're going to have as important a board as this is, you would want to have private sector involvement. Because when we're thinking about this just transition plan that you're going to produce, effectively it sounds like this is led by the Scottish Government. So the Scottish Government is essentially writing a report for itself. And it's not, you know, it's not bringing in anyone from outside. Mm-hmm. One of our earlier sessions, we were hearing from Federation of Small Businesses a real frustration that they're not involved. Why can't you involve the private sector in this board?
I think that's something definitely we would look at kind of going forward as part of this phase three. I think we've got to the point now, we've got the governance in place, we've got the structures, the work streams. As I mentioned before, we are engaged through our respective organisations with industry on a day-to-day basis in the business space that's at Grangemouth, but bringing that together into that collective forum, potentially through GFIB, is an opportunity that we would look at kind of going forward.
Okay. Well, final question from me. The plan, which is going to be produced, when's that going to be ready?
So, in the kicking off the process, Scottish Government, as I said, are leading on that just now in terms of the first phase, which is that baselining, and then the vision overall. So that will be in the next couple of months, bringing together that workshop, particularly around the vision and partners to support that. I'm not quite clear on when the final plan, just transition plan, will be ready, but I can certainly take that back and ask Scottish Government officials.
Okay, that'll be useful.
Leading on perhaps from what Graham Simpson was talking about there, we're talking very much about public sector investments into the Grangemouth area. How is that being leveraged to attract in private investment on the back of that or in partnership with that? I think maybe, Mark, would you be the best person to respond on that one?
In terms of around the Grangemouth area?
Yes.
So, as I said,
as an example.
Sure. When the bank makes our investments, I don't have a particular example to use, but we do seek private sector investment alongside ourselves. And if I go back to
the numbers that the bank's invested £380 million and we've crowded in £650 million from private capital, thereby over £1 billion worth investment within Scotland. That would be the model that we would apply to any investments that we do make in support of Grangemouth and the surrounding areas.
But you've described that you're already in discussion with a number of companies there. Obviously, we don't know what stage that discussion's at, but presumably part of that will be to find a way also to draw in additional capital, additional investment into that area.
Of course, it is. And the opportunities that we look at, there are private capital investors who would be investing alongside the bank.
So that is an active consideration along with what you're doing?
It is.
And so, what about, Derek, what about...
Yes, so I think there's kind of three practical considerations in terms of leveraging private sector investment into opportunities at Grangemouth. The first is ensuring that we're working with companies to develop investable propositions. And it goes back to the point that David made earlier. We can have fantastic companies, as we do in Scotland, and we can have fantastic technology, which we do. But if we don't have investable propositions that investors are keen to invest into, then it's going to be difficult to leverage that private sector investment. So working with companies in terms of the funding that they need and developing an investable proposition is one thing. Second, we know that some of these technologies are a long-term play. It could be 5, 10, 15 years before they're actually commercially viable. And that's not attractive to a lot of investors who are looking for short to medium term return. So there's a need for the public sector to continue to de-risk propositions at the early stage so that further down the line they're at a point where private sector investors are interested in investing. And the third thing is engagement with investors. So identifying and working with investors in the UK and internationally who operate in this space. And increasingly there are more investors that are interested in, as you would expect, low carbon technologies. And then linking those investors and the engagement and the relationships that we've got with them, with the company base that we're supporting through developing those investable propositions, so that we're maximising the opportunity to get investment into companies. And I think if we continue to develop those three areas, then we stand a good chance of maximising or optimising investment, private sector investment into some of these new technologies.
I like the term de-risk. It makes it sound as if it's a proposition that carries no risk at all. Whereas what we're doing is we're transferring the risk to the public sector, in effect, or a degree of that risk. So maybe we should find another terminology for that.
Perhaps.
Anyway, can I ask members if they've got any other questions for the panel? No? In that case, that brings us to the end of the evidence session. And, I thank the panel members for attending today, for the time they've given. And I suspend the meeting. And we'll move to private session. Thank you.
Thank you.